One of the most fascinating things for people, especially seasoned professionals, people with a lot of experience in business and life, like an example would be somebody like Sunil Kote. When he walks into an event and when he sees people now, and then he's walking into another event in 3 months, and he's seeing that the same person looks so different that it's hard to say what is different, but the undeniable thing is the fact that that person has evolved beyond comprehension. The amusing part of this entire thing is how that actual person was transformed is walking around in blissful ignorance of the fact that so much has changed. But through the lens of somebody like a Sunil, so much has changed. What do you have to say about that?
Well, I think we maintain history in our body. You know, today if you go to a search engine like Google, or if you just open your mobile or app and you start using it, the information you get is not the same as the information your friend or your colleagues get. It's because technology today tracks your history. It knows where you have been, what you have done, what you like. And that information is stored in their server and it personalizes the content for you. But for us as humans, the information, the history of the experiences we've had, the kind of thoughts we go through, the happiness in our life, the relationships we maintain is stored in our body. So we maintain history, and our actions, the way, the why we give out to people, the way people perceive us is all written in our neurology. So it's a common thing that most people, when they meet somebody, they say, I get a vibe about this person. And the vibe is not just something that's happening in that moment. The vibe is happening because the things that a person has done, the experiences they've created for themselves, get stored as behaviors, as habits, as micro muscle patterns that are not consciously visible to the naked eye, but then they are visible to the naked eye. Even though they don't notice that, when they meet this person, they sense it, they feel it. So one of the things we do at UP is we take care of making sure that people have great experiences once they leave the program. Is that they stop feeling jealous or anxiety or anger, and instead they are filled with drive and emotions that are exhilarating in nature. So they're looking at their ambitions and goals, but instead of getting stressed about it, they're feeling exhilarated in their body. Now what happens is every day they go through that experience after the event, their body is now storing a new history. So when they come after 3 months, when they come after 6 months, they are going to look and feel and respond as a different person. Now, good people, good business people know how to hire the right people. And they're not necessarily looking at a resume, or they're not looking at a list of check boxes to see who to hire. They're looking at that trait in the person. When they find the right person, they just know it. And most of the times, these are just judgments they rely on based on their intuition. You know, they might give you a reason saying, well, that person said this, or the person displayed confidence. But then when many people show confidence, they still know who is the right person for that particular job. And a lot of time this comes from their own experience about people. And I think it's very difficult to hide a history, especially to seasoned business people. Because business people, whether they want to hire or they want to partner with you, they're very intuitive about who they work with. Like, I was once having dinner with an investor. He told me that in the first 15 minutes he makes his decision about whether he wants to invest in a particular founder or not. And he says, I have no logical reason. I just know if I want to invest in that person or not. And a lot of people at the top make their decisions like that. It's based on their understanding of human behavior and nature. And it's very difficult to hide your past from people like that. If you have been thinking for 10 days about all the things that can go wrong in your life, and then this morning, you wake up in the morning and you say, I'm going to crack this deal and I'm going to be a positive thinker, you might look superficially happy on the outside, but a seasoned businessman could read through you. They could look at you and they could see where you're actually coming from. I mean, I know this is possible because this is what I do in my work. I might meet a 2,000 crore business owner walking in, and I might look at him and say, what is so sad in your life? And he would ask me, how do you know? And most of the time my answer is, it's written all over your face. You know, he might be smiling at that point in time, but then I think once you start developing the eye for it, you start noticing what people have done, what they're continuing to do, and what they will do in the future. Because the important thing about history is that history repeats. Patterns don't change unless you deliberately interrupt the pattern and then you set forward a new direction. And that is the work we do. So when people come to UP, we are interrupting their pattern. And once we interrupt their pattern, we are setting them in a new direction. So once they are in a new direction, the experiences that they create is different. The thoughts are different. The way their body responds to that is different. The history that they're creating in the future for themselves is different. So later, 6 months from then, when somebody looks at them, they're definitely going to see that this person is a new person. We just heard a story about somebody who got hired in a very, very senior position where he is launching a big multi-billion dollar organization's launch in India. He's the first hire. And the boss who hired him knew him from earlier, and he said, the person I knew you to be before, I wouldn't have given you this job. The thing is, people make decisions based on their first look at you, based on your small interactions with them. They understand how serious you are, how committed you are. And these are not things you can fake, at least not when you're dealing with real serious and experienced, seasoned business people. Now, when you're going for a job interview, you're going to the HR channel, it's a different procedure. You know, you have check boxes to fill in. But when you're being hired or partnering with somebody who is a decision maker, who's managing profit and loss, who's an entrepreneur, then they're looking for completely different things. And I think it's very difficult to hide who you are. It shows. You know, the person you are shows whether you want it or not. The question is not changing who you are momentarily. The experience has to be to change who you are from within, so that in the weeks and months, you live new experiences, you create new thoughts to the point that it shows on the outside. That you just interact, be who you are, be natural, but the vibe you give out is different. People look at you and have confidence in the things that you say. And it's not about what you say. It's not even about body language as to, do I broaden my shoulder or do I lower my voice? It has to be a natural vibe. A natural vibe comes from stored patterns. Patterns come from repetition. Repetition comes from breaking an existing pattern and creating a new pattern instead. And that's what we do it up.
The person, you know, who is on the other side, who is sometimes oblivious of the magnanimity of change that will happen for them. But when Antano and Honey look at that same person, they feel dramatically different about something that has shifted. So how is this difference arising? What's going on?
So we had this ex-model who is in the television, and she's going through a bad patch in her life. Do the UP program, and we met her for a post review after 2 months. And as soon as she came in, people asked her, how are you after the event? She said, well, something has changed really, but I don't know what it is. And from her, the way she said it, you would probably rate that she changed to the degree of a 3 on 10. And then she saw her pre-interview and the interview she just did. And she looked at both of them and she said, I can't believe I've changed so much as a person. And that is like 10 on 10. And that's an experience that is natural to us. When we become fat, it happens slowly. When we become thin, it happens slowly. When we become dark or fair, it happens slowly. And it's only when somebody looks at you and says, hey, you used to be thinner before, that you actually realize that the magnitude of difference. You know, sometimes when they show you advertisements of a white tea, they show you two whites next to each other. Because our brain recognizes difference when they are in close proximity. So if suppose you are like a fat person today and tomorrow if you become thin, you would know it. But if you become thin after like 3 months, you have to have external measurements to know. But like, you know, like your clothes are not fitting you in the same way anymore. And I think that's the same with personal habits. It's the same with personal excellence. When people gradually evolve, at UP, what we do is we set people to become better every day at what they do and how they think. So it's on an autopilot to evolve. So they're getting more happier states, intense states, focused states. It's translating into work. They're getting new opportunities that translates back into how they feel. And so when they keep evolving, it's a very gradual but incremental process. So when people have a reference of who they were yesterday, they would have a reference of who they were day before yesterday. They may not necessarily have a reference of who they were 3 months ago. But a person who's in the business of evolving people, it's necessary he or she has the memory to remember exactly how the person sounded, how they walk, the words they use, their micromuscle movements, the tone of their voice, their thought patterns, their mindsets, and to look at them after 3 months and to notice the difference. I think it comes down to memory. It's are you paying attention to a person and you're capturing snapshots of them across time? It's like literally like what the model did. She saw the pre-video and she saw her video after 3 months answering the same question about what she wants from life. And then she said, wow. Now, if you could play this in your head, then I think you would be able to notice when people are transforming in the right way or the wrong way, and then make the necessary adjustments accordingly.
So at any given point in time, how does one know whether they're heading in the right direction or not? Because sometimes there could be temporary setbacks. I've always heard him talk about regress and progress. At any given point in time, how does one, what's the self-barometer to know that, hey, something is going wrong, I better get some help. Or everything is going great. I am in the right direction. How does one know that?
You never know where you're heading towards. You know, Kodak, for instance, is like a huge multinational company, $1 billion in revenue, and overnight it's come down to a crash, and nobody even buys anything from that company anymore. It doesn't even exist, and businesses are all the time crashing and growing, happy couples who are like so happily married, and suddenly one of the partner comes and says, I want a divorce. And it's a shock because the person might have thought that this is a perfect marriage. And I think one of the ways to inoculate yourself from that is to open your eyes and ears to look for new opportunities. Because sometimes not going after an opportunity could be a mistake. If you don't grow, if you don't expand, then chances are somebody else is going to and wipe you off. That's what happened at Kodak. Like, they didn't go to the digital camera when the whole world was operating over there. They were closed within their operational model. Now, you're not talking about idiots over here. You're talking about highly talented people who grew a multi-billion dollar empire. Now, if they could do that, many people could. The challenge is, a lot of times we are boxed in a time and money cycle. Like, we have certain priorities, certain deliverables, certain time requirements from us, and there is a pattern, there's a loop going on and on and on and on and on and on. I think just the same way that as people who are evolving excellence for others, the same way we are able to interrupt someone's pattern and help them go in a different direction, I think one of the superior capability people need to develop is to interrupt their own patterns. And to be able to step back, look at it, and then look at where this is heading in 2 years, 3 years, 10 years, across all aspects of their life. And then, you know, like, for example, divorces don't happen because One of the spouse cheated on the other. Divorces happen because one of them stopped giving time to the other. And then it slowly starts building up. But then both of them are caught in such a vicious cycle that they wouldn't be able to notice that something is not going as well as it should be. And if they're able to notice, they would be able to step back and interrupt that pattern. And a lot of time I've also seen people who notice what is going on, but they don't have the power to interrupt their own patterns in their life. And so I think the ability to pause, to step back, to become a different human being, and to evaluate it as different personalities. One of the things we do for our own business is, you know, every time we expand, every time we take up a new opportunity, we evaluate it as different persons. You know, we have 20 consultants. And sometimes we ask the question, what would X do? What would Y do? What would Z say? And that's not because we don't know enough of our business. It's because we want to evaluate it from all possibilities and not just being who we are. And I think it's a superior capability to be able to step outside of your shoe and then step into other people's shoe and see what is going on. So I think if you have these two capabilities, the ability to become someone else on demand, right? Like a lot of times you meet people and you don't understand why a deal isn't closing with them. And I've met people like that, you know, either because they want to become a director or they're going after a very big deal, and then they don't understand why they're not getting that. And what I do is I go through a comprehensive process where I help them shift their identity momentarily to become the other person. Now, we'd say, oh, sounds very easy to see, put yourself in the other person's shoes. But when most people try to do that, what they're really doing is they're trying to put themselves in the other person's shoes, but they're still thinking from their own logic, from their own emotional states. But to really put yourself in the other person's shoes is to take on that person's logic and to take on that person's emotions. And children can do this very easily. You've seen them play games like, you know, they become the parent and then they exaggerate the movements. But as they grow up, humans seems to lose the ability to do that. But I think if you could learn again to be able to change perceptual positions, become another person on demand, then I think you develop the ability to look at things holistically from every angle. And if you combine that with your capability to interrupt patterns and to change them, then you are in a better, because a lot of times you also need to do trial and error. You know, if something isn't working, what you do is, like, your relationship is going down the drain, then what you do is you interrupt whatever pattern is going on and try a new pattern. And then if that doesn't work, you try another pattern. Because a lot of times the answers are not fixed. The answers are not written. And your unique and your situation is very unique. So you need the ability to experiment. But you can't experiment if you don't have the speed. If it's going to take 10 years for you to change a pattern, and if it doesn't work, then you've lost 10 years. So I think the ability to quickly interrupt patterns and to quickly bring about change in interactions and relationships gives you the power and ability to validate what is working for you and what is taking your life and your family in the right direction.
So these capabilities that you're talking about are not taught anywhere. This is not what our education system teaches. This is not what you get in the school. This is not what you get in the college. This is not even what you get in the MBA school. So what are the chances that a person develops these things that you're talking about? It's like there's no book written on how do you develop them. There's no movie written on how do you develop. It's the gray area that I don't even know if it is in the awareness of so many people, of people in general. Like, they may not even know that these are things that they can develop or that needs to be developed. What do we do about that? Like,
well, one of the problems of the society is that we're becoming a very specialistic society. You know, like, everything you study, you study to the depth of a particular specialization. And the problem with that is sometimes you start looking at components and optimizing components. But then when you think of systems as a whole, you might have an optimized component, but that optimization might be bad for the entire system. Like, you know, like be it education or be it how you raise a child, You can't look at the child in isolation and understand whether he or she is faring well. You got to look at the child in relation to the environment, to the parents, to the grandparents, to the relatives, to where he or she is growing and what's happening in the industry outside, for you to get an understanding of what's going on with the child. So I wouldn't simplify it calling a holistic view, because it's not like you have one picture, but it's more like you understand the nitty-gritties of the child, you understand the nitty-gritties of the society, you understand the nitty-gritties of the relationship, dynamics within the family, conscious and unconscious, and you understand how all of these things work together. And this is called systemic thinking. Your ability to see things as systems, as connected, interconnected web of things. And I think that is what learning and development is about. It's never an individual or isolated activity. You know, you have these rags to riches stories where people talk about how they just, you know, did some great things all by themselves. But what they don't realize is that there are so many people who helped them on the way. There are so many things that came together at the right time for things to happen. And I think it's very important for our society to start continuing to specialize in things, but also to promote the idea of being good enough in various other things, so that in addition to being a specialist, you also have the capability to know how things go along with each other. Now, sometimes you find musicians, to give you an analogy, you know, who are very good guitarists, or you find people who are very good drummers, and they might be very good at what they do, but they may not be good as a band, because they just don't know how the music of the rest of the people are flowing along. So knowing just an instrument, knowing just music in relation to who they are, isn't as good as being able to play music in relation to everybody else outside. And that is what separates a composer from other musicians, is that they think of music, when they compose, they think of music as all the pieces coming together. They understand the intricacies of what a guitar could bring, what a drum could bring, what a djembe could bring, what a other instrument can bring, but they also understand how they all interact with each other, when to leave a pause, when to keep things going, when it should be going on in the background. And I think personal evolution is like that. You gotta look at the intricacies of the relationship and connection between what is your growth, how does it impact every component of your life, you know, your relationship, and how does your growth in one area influence the growth in the other area? Because only when you look at it strategically, you could decide which aspects requires the most immersive involvement and commitment from you. See, the thing is, there are a million things in which you can evolve. But always evolving and growth comes in two phases. It comes with fascination. You are fascinated by something amazing, and then the second part is the most important. It's a commitment, right? Because I've seen people, especially at the age of 20 to 25, maybe 35 too, who suddenly see somebody playing a guitar, they want to play a guitar. They suddenly see somebody playing a drum, they want to play a drum. They suddenly see somebody starting a business, they want to start a business. They suddenly see somebody starting another business, they want to do that too. So that doesn't help, because then you would be just dabbling. But the important thing is, you could do several things as long as you commit to what you are doing. And the commitment and immersion is a very important aspect of development. It takes time. You got to master something. See, because you could be the average, you can be as an average dabbling around with things and get mediocre results. Or you could be a master at something, and then people will break rules to make your demands come true. And they would go out of the way to make sure that you are there in their business. And if you want to get to the top, you got to have commitment. You got to commit to learning. You got to commit to becoming better at whatever it is that you do, and or whatever that you aren't doing that you need to start doing. And how do you choose? So if evolving yourself in different areas takes time, it could take 3 years, it could take 4 years. Out of a plethora of things that you can improve on, how do you choose? How do you prioritize? What's your strategy? Your strategy can't be, let me first do this. Your strategy has to come from what you want to finally achieve. Because a strategy is long term. You look at the final outcome and you think backwards. So you then decide what is the immediate thing that you have to improve and innovate on. And that is why it's so important as a society for us to understand how to become systemic thinkers. How to, you know, the things that you do at home is having an impact on so many people. And you may or may not realize that. You know, simple things, you know. Today, a lot of children go to depression, and it's not their fault. You know, it's something that is, and you know, there was a study that was done by Gregory Bateson, and one of the papers he published is called The Double Bind Theory, that talks about how families are responsible for the development of schizophrenic behaviors. And you know, you might just think that it's a condition, but then there was a start for everything. And for that to start, there was something else that must have happened. And if you could open your eyes and ears to the complexities, see, because people like to simplify things, but you cannot simplify things more than it's possible. If something is complex, you know, you can't say, I will only learn algebra, but I want to fly, I want to create an aeroplane. You know, you got to understand the max if you want to create an aeroplane. It's not algebra. You got to understand the max necessary to explain the laws that govern the flight of an aeroplane. So you got to appreciate the complexity involved in things in order for you to be able to maneuver them. And you can't simplify human communication, you can't simplify human relationships into one basket, two basket, or ABC rules. You have to understand the complexities. And then you have to look at all of them together as a whole, and then decide where is the smallest change that you can make that'll make the biggest difference.
What is your process? What do you do when you look at something?
Well, I would think if they live for 200 years, what would they do? And can we help them do that in like 40, 50 years instead of waiting 200 years? Because that's what time compression is. You know, I feel like if somebody lives for 200 years, most people will create a legacy. Because by the time they're like 60, 70, they start to realize their mistakes, and then they start to realize, this is what I should have done. Well, why can't they start that a little earlier? You know, so I feel like, who would they be if they lived 200 years? And I think of, can I make that happen today? Without them having to go through all the time doing things that they would regret, or not doing things that they could have easily done right now. Because a lot of people don't realize the opportunities they have in their life. You know, most times people are looking at, you know, solutions in so many different ways, where the solution is right in front, it's so obvious. And my job is to help people arrive there. And sometimes people don't see things because of who they are. So my job is not to show them the solution, but my job is to think of what is clogging their mind. I mean, how are they thinking right now that is not allowing them to see what is already there in their life? And once I help them to transform from within in that particular way, they start seeing the opportunities that they didn't see earlier. So I'm looking for, you know, if this person lived for 200 years, what are the opportunities that are tapped into? And what must be true in their behaviors, in their mindset, in their thinking, in their patterns, for them to not arrive there by themselves already? And then we figure out a way to clear it out. We figure out a way to remove the pebbles, install superior capabilities that gets people to get there immediately.
So for somebody who's already doing very well, for somebody who's, it could be somebody who's, you know, maybe it's a family business, they're taking on that legacy. Maybe it's a person who's a first generation entrepreneur who's, you know, come up with these fantastic ideas. Somehow they met the right people at the right time. And they're doing really, really well already, right? How will a person like that know that they'll continue to grow rapidly? What's the way, what are some things that somebody who's already doing really well also, Like, what should they do? And how does Antano and Honey help somebody who's already doing very well? Like, what are some things that they build for people like them?
So, when people are doing well, I look at, do they have a successor? Do they have someone in the family who could run the family business after them? Are they good mentors? Most times when we've helped family businesses, what we've found is that there are two types of categories we worked with. One is the category where the next generation is in alignment with the first generation, but they just are not ready. They need a little more preparation. They know it, their parents know it, but they just don't know what the way is. They try going to an education like an MBA, but they still feel like there's something about them that is not quite yet there when they look at how their, you know, the previous generation function. At the same time, they have these big dreams. They see ideas of how to transform the company, take it to the next level. So what we do is we get people ready. We help them develop capabilities that generally take a long time, you know, like for example, in negotiation, in understanding the intention of the person, even before the person says what they're about to say, are things that good business people understand over a period of time. But then, can we accelerate it? Instead of waiting for 10 years, can we help them develop that in like 6 months or a year? So we make the next generation ready. Then there's the other kind, where the first generation and the next generation are not in alignment. And there you gotta help them first come together as one family. And sometimes the things that they may be arguing about might be so silly compared to the outcome that they both want to achieve. But then when they are stuck in that rut, it's very difficult for them to see it differently. So we don't advise, we don't counsel. What we do instead is we help them develop superior state choice, presence of mind, and capabilities that allows them naturally to start seeing things differently. And I think for somebody who is already at the top, they really need to look at the succession, you know, sometimes from within the family, sometimes from outside, because, you know, there's a lot of things that founders and businessmen learn on the job. And somebody is coming to the job, they may not necessarily have the context in which they can develop those same skills and capabilities. So it's up to the person to ensure that there is an environment where such opportunities are provided. And then for the next generation, which is taking up the business, obviously the idea is most of them aren't sure if their father wasn't there, can they still handle the business? And most times the fears are correct because they may not yet be ready to understand who to trust, whom not to trust. You might hire somebody, train them for 5 years, and he might be a competitor for you 5 years later. Because you see, you got to understand, when you hire people, you got to understand, especially when you're hiring people at very senior roles, you got to understand what drives them. Is it money? Is it passion? Is it a desire to do something? Is it invention? And different people are driven differently. But nobody, if you go and ask somebody what drives you, what they're going to write down is not going to be what actually drives them. And I think good business people understand this. They naturally know what drives a person. And I think these are some of the capabilities that the next generation has to learn and prepare themselves with so that two things can happen. So that when there is a threat from outside, because most times any good business will start having threats, you know, because they have to keep evolving and getting their game to the next big thing that's happening. And so when that happens, they need to know how to handle that. And the second thing is at some point in time, they have to start taking responsibility for the business. And most times, the first generation is very happy to let go of all responsibilities as soon as they feel their children are ready to take on. But most time, parents also have a good intuition of when their children are not ready, even when the child thinks that they are. And I think when people come to me with that problem, I just tell them, let's evolve you to the point you can start contributing, you can start adding value to the business. You know, if you're making X crores, can you bring in Y crores? Addition to the business, then what is already been going on? When you start adding value like that, you start building trust with people. You know, people start noticing that you are capable of bringing in things, executing to them, and that is how you win trust, and that is how you become ready. That is how you learn. You don't learn from going to a college or from textbook, you learn by doing. And to be able to do, you gotta go and bring in business, you gotta create value, and you gotta deliver to that business. And sometimes you may want to take a pie from the existing business, sometimes you might develop new markets. But what allows you to be creative? How do you start innovating? How do you start finding that right client? These are the things that we develop for people at UP. You know, we develop capabilities that makes it easier for them to go ahead with these things in a shorter time. Yeah, so in short, instead of them taking over the company after 40 years, can they take leadership positions there? Can they actually drive business in like 2-3 years? That's what you're looking for.
But for a lot of families, entrepreneurship is unthinkable. This particular sect of people, they're also battling something new because they're sort of fighting the mindset of their father that says, save for a rainy day, save, work, secure your future. But an entrepreneurial mindset is completely different, especially when you're a first generation entrepreneur. It's not very likely that you have too much money on your hands or you have the luxuries, some of the luxuries that a family-owned business has. What specifically is the process that Antano and Honey that you do when you see somebody like that?
A lot of people confuse freelancing from entrepreneurship. Freelancing is a stepping stone to entrepreneurship. You know, when you start as a, we tell people that, you know, the way to break from the cycle of no time and no money is to become really good at something, is to start up. You know, is to me, starting up is becoming exceptionally good at something that you do. The story that comes to my mind often is, you know, there was a point in our history where slaves could literally become free if they just could cross the border, which didn't necessarily have military guarding it. If they could just cross the border from one state and go into the other state. There was also one famous case where the girl had to just open the door of the hotel she was brought along to. And if she leaves the door, she's a free lady. And, you know, people have lost their life fighting for freedom, you know, because freedom is such an important thing. People who want to do what they want to do have lost lives. And there has always been this opportunity where they just have to travel from one place to another to get their freedom. Sometimes the travel has been risky. Sometimes it's been a free passage. But most people didn't take the freedom because they didn't know that if they just went to the other state, they are free. And I was thinking, what is the equivalent of that in today's world? You know, because everybody is seemed to be caught in a rut of no time and no money. If you look at most of the divorce that happens, most of the deaths that happens in health conditions, it happens because people couldn't give time to themselves or they couldn't give time for someone they love. And people don't have time, and they don't have, they feel like if they have more money, they will have more time. And they're investing all their time to make more money. And the way to break that pattern, the way to break that cycle, the way to interrupt that pattern is to start up. That's the equivalent of you know, becoming free in today's world. And to me, starting up does not mean you register a company. Starting up means you become irreplaceable. You become extraordinary at something that you do. And that can take 5 years, that can take 10 years. Even with time compression, it can take 4 years. But some people never get that extraordinary. They're always average. So they could never break free from that pattern. And if someone can become extraordinary, then they can break the pattern of, you know, no time and no money. But For me, the idea is freelancing is one of the ways that you can become extraordinary. Is you can start taking small projects and you can start charging people for what you are good at. But the problem with freelancing is it's not forever. They earn reasonably well, they have a great quality of life because they could work for 10 days and then chill for another 20 days. I had that lifestyle when I was 21, 22. I used to go do technology trainings and then, make a few lakhs every month and then go travel, learn new things and have fun. But at some point in your life, you have to recognize that you need to change yourself from a freelancer into a business. Because when you're a freelancer, it is running on you entirely. And there is no guarantee for the future. So most freelancers, 10, 15 years down the line, they can't continue freelancing in their expertise because the younger generation is going to take them over. They can put in more hard work, they can do it for cheaper rates. The difference between a freelancer and a business is freelancing is kind of generic. You are hireable for a particular common problem that people have. But when you're converting yourself from a freelancer to an entrepreneur, often you're finding a unique opportunity that nobody has thought of. Nobody's called you and said, like, hey, can you solve this problem? Or can you do it in this particular way? But because of your expertise in that profession and your creativity, and that's why I think creativity is a basic ingredient for entrepreneur. You know, creativity is not, a lot of people think that painting and music is creativity. Creativity is not painting or music. Creativity is what you do in music and painting and in business when constraints are put on you. See, the whole idea of creativity is anybody can play music, you know, if they go through enough training. But then when you put in constraints, when you say this movie has to bring in this particular feel, but this is the situation and there is a constraint, you can't use something that you already know, then creativity comes. Creativity comes from constraints. You know, there are two types of people and you put constraints, they say not possible. And then there's the other kind who figure out a way. So that's creativity. Simply being artistic does not mean you're creative, but your ability to improve things when there are constraints is creativity. And you can bring creativity into business. And I think that if you're good, if you're extraordinary at what you do, and you're freelancing and you're extraordinary at what you do, there will come a point in your life where your creativity allows you to find solutions for common problems in your field of expertise that nobody has thought of implementing until now. Most startups, most billion-dollar organizations come up like that. They see a problem not somewhere else, but in the work they do every day. And then they solve it. They bring in their creativity to solve it. It's that moment you convert yourself from a freelancer who's generic. You know, like if you're, you're a good soft skill trainer, then you have to compete between, you know, are you a better soft skills learner than the other person or not? And corporates are going to look at you as, okay, there are 10 soft skill trainers, you're one of them, right? Now, or maybe you're freelancing as a chef, or maybe you're freelancing as a singer, or whatever in the profession that you are into. But that's freelancing, it's generic, and people invite you. But the moment you convert, you bring in creativity, you solve a problem that hasn't been solved before, you transform yourself into an entrepreneur, you're becoming kind of unique. What you do is unique. People haven't thought that it is possible to solve that problem in that particular way. Now here's the challenge. How can you sell something to people that they haven't seen or heard of before? And that's a challenge every inventor, every entrepreneur goes through. That's universal. I mean, think about this. When somebody invented a car, how would have he thought of conveying what a car is when people haven't seen car before? What about electricity? How did people take electricity to the masses? These are problems. These are business problems. Often people, entrepreneurs, think if you have a good idea, you can actually get good business. Not necessarily, because people are closed in patterns. They continue to do what they have always been doing. And if you're creating something that is out of the box, that nobody has thought of before, then you need to have your personal charisma and your ability to convey things in a simple way, along with conviction, in order for you to get people to understand and experience what is it that you have to offer. And this is the stage where a lot of entrepreneurs fail. So, you know, to me, entrepreneurship is about invention. It's about finding that niche area, finding that unique opportunity, creating a solution, and then getting your clients. You become an entrepreneur when you have accumulated enough clients who have taken your solution, implemented it, and are happy about what they have received. And I think the confusion is a lot of people are freelancers and they think themselves as entrepreneurs. But I think entrepreneurship is serious business. Entrepreneurship requires that you're creative, you're solving a unique problem, and you're able to acquire customers who are able to see the futuristic thinking in you and buy that solution and are happy about it. And I think that moment you have converted, you have upgraded yourself from a freelancer to an entrepreneur. Now, I'm not recommending entrepreneurship for everybody. At some point in your life, freelancing is the way to go. It's a great lifestyle. But at some point, I think it's also important that you see and develop and be ready, because a lot of times in your journey as a freelancer, you will encounter unique situations. You will encounter people. You will encounter things. You feel like, can I solve this problem? Hey, why hasn't nobody done that before? And you can be somebody who thinks of why hasn't anyone done that before and whine about it. Or you could say, why hasn't someone done that before? Let's see if we can make that a $1 billion market. And I think that is the kind of preparation that I would recommend for entrepreneurs, that you're able to immerse, commit, convince, and these are things that requires training. Just like you have training for music, sports, education, you need training for business skills. People think of, you know, the saddest part once upon a time was that there was no college or university degree for sales. Although that's one of the most important functions of a business. And in the same way, I feel that the business skills have to be closely associated with understanding human mindset and what will make it click in the market. And unfortunately, that's not necessarily where our business education is centered around. It's not, the business education in today's scenario is not centered around the psychology of people. It's not centered around how do people make decisions? How do people get introduced to innovations? And I think those are the skills that you need to equip yourself with in order to become an entrepreneur who's ready to take on the unseen opportunities that will keep coming at you in your journey as an entrepreneur.
So is it a good idea for entrepreneurs to pursue maybe a course in psychology? The most obvious solution that I can think of, that people think of, is, you know, pursue something in psychology. And I think somewhere there's this perception that NLP is related to psychology, and somehow people find NLP more accessible. Given the fact that this is the most important aspect of sales and business, and it's not covered in business education that we currently have, how does one get there? What do you do for that?
Well, you learn wherever you put your focus and attention. You know, like there are some people who see colors everywhere and they're good painters. And there are some people, when you play a song, the only thing that they can hear is the guitar, and then they're good guitar players. There are some people who can only hear the lyrics of the song, and then they become poets. You know, so people learn where they put their attention. And to me, if you really want to become good at understanding human beings and the mindsets and what gets them to think different, then you got to put your attention there. You got to, and as I said earlier, it starts with fascination and then a commitment. You know, if you can commit yourself to put your attention about human psychology for 2-3 years, you'll naturally become good at it. But you also need a context that encourages you to put your attention on it. And there are several things I can think of. One of the simplest things you can do is start doing sales, you know, either for your father's business or either for your friend's business or for your own business. Start maybe, I'm not talking about this kind of sales where you're in a shop and then saying, come buy. I'm talking about big sales, closing deals, you know. It could be like a partnership with a really prestigious institute, or it could be that partnership with a competitor, or it could be closing a big garment deal, or it could be closing a $1 million order. But the moment you start involving yourself in closing deals, then you're giving yourself a context where it's necessary for you to understand people. And I think if you commit yourself to doing that, see, the thing is, a lot of times when people join a sales and marketing role, they are going through a template. They're going through targets. Somebody, the business owner, has understood the psychology. He or she has set a particular way of selling things. And then they're going and selling after those things. So doing sales as a salesperson is not going to help you understand the psychology of people. But doing sales as a business owner will help you understand the psychology of people. As a business owner, you're not looking after targets, you're looking at innovation. You're looking at how to get through to people. You're not looking at follow-up. You're looking at, how do I say this differently? Why wouldn't somebody get it yet? So there's a big difference between doing sales as a salesperson and doing sales as an entrepreneur. But I think one of the activities people can do is, if they can commit a year to doing sales as an entrepreneur, then I think they'll definitely evolve their ability to understand people and influence them. It's one of the things that really helps people do to change. The other thing is looking into your own family. You know, sometimes you might have children, sometimes you might have relatives, and every family has challenges. And sometimes you can accept the challenge, sometimes you can ignore the challenge, but you could also have a third option. You can look at, how can I break the pattern in this family? How can I help them, or help my own family, come together differently? And then you keep at it. And that is, and once you're able to make that in your family, you're not just helping your family, but you've also evolved yourself to become capable enough to understand different people, differences in the way they think, and to be able to shift it. If you could do that there, you could do that in your business too. Because at the core level, shifting mindsets is the same. We all have the same neurology. Your context might change, you know, in business and in family, but you're working with the same human neurology. So you could either do sales as a business owner, or you could close deals, or you could start evolving families around you, starting with your own. All of these things leads to developing a good psychology. The challenges, all of this leads to developing good understanding and psychology of people. The challenge is, most people are not capable to do sales, close deals, or transform families, because they could step into their own family and they get angry, or they get irritated, or they feel hopeless. That's not a position from where you can change your family. Or some people are hesitant about closing deals. Some people don't yet see an opportunity, because closing deals is also a creative process. Sometimes you see an opportunity to close a deal that two parties haven't seen before, and suddenly it's a win-win-win for everybody. So people sometimes are not in that creative state. So I think you got to make yourself ready and capable to be creative, to be in the right presence, the right state of mind, and then jump into the context that I have mentioned. That is far better than trying to read a book or go through a course, because nothing on earth is going to teach you about human psychology other than your own experience. But it's important that when you have the experience, that you're in the right state of mind to be able to learn from it and evolve yourself. That's how you do it.
So from what you're saying, I'm understanding that your experience,
yeah,
in life, the deeper layer to what governs your experience is your capabilities.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's sort of a little bit like a, you know, like, the more you give yourself some experience, chances are that your capabilities develop, or you know, it might backfire. But what's the role that Antano and Ani play in all of this? How do they equip people?
What we do, Harini and I, is help people develop capabilities fast. You know, there are some capabilities that are significant, that are important for people to have new experiences. We look at those capabilities, like, you know, the ability to be, there are several capabilities, like, you know, the ability to be on demand, available for the job at hand. You know, sometimes your job might want you to negotiate. Sometimes your job might want you to complete a particular technical process. Sometimes your job might want you to stay a little longer. And at the same time, when you go back home, you want to be able to go and do the things that you want to do. A lot of times people don't have the capability to shift those states. And people don't have the capabilities to become another person. People don't have the capabilities to look at their own work differently. I think these are the enabler capabilities. So what Harini and I do is we develop the enabler capabilities first. Once you have those capabilities, then you start having new opportunities. Then you start having new life experiences. Then you have more capabilities. And then it becomes a cycle that continues to get bigger and bigger by itself. And because things like hesitation, it's very easy to feel like I shouldn't hesitate. But then when you have a hesitation to sales, you wouldn't hesitate until the moment occurs. And that's a neurological process. That's a biochemical process. You got to have overcome that before the moment occurs. And that requires certain repetition in your neurology, and it has to be systematic and targeted and gone after, because you can't just think positive thinking or I will do it will help you overcome the hesitation. For those who don't hesitate, they'll never hesitate. For those who hesitate, they keep hesitating. You got to break that pattern scientifically, and I think that is where neuro-linguistic programming comes in. It gives you the tools to break certain patterns. People think of, you know, when people talk about up, they say, I don't have 6 days. And I say, whether I'm not asking you for 6 days, I'm asking you for 24 days in the next 3 years. And whether you have 24 days or not is dependent on how small or big your dream is. For some people, if they're telling me they don't have 24 days to make another 200 crores, then what are they doing with all the 300 days that they have this year?
What are installations? It baffles me when people say that so much has changed. When people are looking different. When I'm watching all these videos on xmininstallation.com and people are saying such amazing things. What is it? Like, how do they do what they do? Like,
you cannot change the nature of a person. You cannot straighten a twisted dog's tail. Unless there is a moment of disaster or criticality that happens in that person's life and they naturally change. Most of the stories you heard about rags to riches happens when they were pushed to the brink, where they're about to kill themselves, or you know, where they're about a shipwreck, or when somebody they loved just happened to leave them and go. And that's when people change. So there's enough evidence in history that the nature of a person can change. And when it changes, it doesn't change in 5 years, it doesn't change in 10 years, it changes in that moment. It changes in the moment where that situation occurred. What if you can have a scientific process to repeatably evoke the same result without the disaster? That's installations.
So what's this process like? So how do you replicate it? Is it like a simulation? Is it like a drama? Is it like a theater setup? How do you create such an experience for a person?
We have been doing installations for thousands of years without knowing they are installations. You know, in the olden days, grandparents used to tell their grandchildren stories, and people used to hang around as communities. You have the folklore, you have, you know, a lot of traditions that we follow. In every country, there are traditions and there are rituals that are created where there is a natural form of storytelling involved. Though storytelling, you don't explain the meaning of the story. Sometimes you don't even explain the meaning of that story. But you do a particular tradition, or you do a particular ritual. And these are metaphors that were used at one point to pass on values from one generation to another. So historically speaking, people have always had the rich one-to-one experience of telling stories from one generation to another. And most times it's been from one generation to two generations after. So if you listen to any of the great speeches that has stirred a revolution, you will often find stories inside of them where the speaker hasn't necessarily explained what is the meaning or why he or she is telling that story at that point in time. For centuries, for thousands of years, some scientists say ever since mankind developed intelligence, for millions of years, we have been natural storytellers. And sometimes you meet people who are great business people and you start talking to them and they start telling you stories and you start thinking, what's the relevance of that? You know, but the idea is there's a natural part of the brain that knows how to do installations. There's a natural ability in human beings to start telling stories that are metaphorical in nature, that produces a mind shift in the other person. However, what's happening in recent days is that we are disconnected. We are nuclear families. We don't have access to the grandparents. The grandparents are not catching up with the society realities of their children, grandchildren. There's no rapport between people who are telling the stories and people who are listening to the stories. So there is a whole gap in the natural flow of installations. And I think what we're doing is just understanding how installations have worked for centuries, how installations worked. When Milton Erickson did it, he used to teach medical doctors, and during his demonstrations, he would tell stories and people would hear the stories and come back to him being a new person, being a different person altogether, overcoming their limitations. He's helped people win Olympics and a variety of things. And he used to always do it by telling stories. Now, Dr. John Grinder, what he did was he studied the work of Milton Erickson. He saw in what context did Milton tell those stories? What effect did these stories have in that person 2 months from then, 3 months from then, a year from then? And then when John was able to replicate the same by himself, he quoted what Milton is doing. And a lot of what is taught as NLP today doesn't necessarily cover the aspect of installation. They have something called a strategy installation, which is not the same as what we are referring to here as shifting mindsets using metaphors or parables. So although we have been doing this for centuries, it is only recently that, you know, when John quoted Milton, that we have a systematic way of how installations can be done. Now, it is not as important to know to do installations as to have the skill to know what installations to do. See, because installations at the end of the day is a tool. It's, you know, like a lot of tools that you have, like your mobile, your gadgets, your vehicles, your maybe a hammer and a screwdriver. These are all tools. What matters is how you put the tool to use. And often I don't do a lot of installations. I'm looking at what are the 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the smallest number of installations that are required in order to change the trajectory of that person's life by changing them and evolving their core nature. Often it has to do with completing their rarity, because I feel like every person brings in a very rare and unique experience based on their personal history. But it's also an incomplete rarity that they bring, because a lot of time people are good at a lot of things, but then they need to learn a couple more things, or they need to complete what they are doing with a few additional things for that rarity to become complete, for that combination to click. And I'm looking at what capabilities do we have to evolve so that the person completes their rarity. And so for me, the more important question is, how do you know what installations to go after? Because you can learn how to do installations, it's a tool. But what will take you a lifetime of experience? What will take you What has taken me time to learn is why this installation for this person. And I have learned that because of the multitude of people we've worked with, you know, from all walks of life. You know, we work with doctors, we work with business people, and when they come in and we help them solve their problems, be it in their family, in their personal life, or in their business, and when we develop capabilities and we see the impact of it in 2 years and 3 years, we realize, oh, this capability is important in these situations. Oh, that capability is important in those situations. And sometimes we develop a couple of capabilities and they spontaneously develop another one. And after 1 year, when we see them growing, we realize an importance of a capability that we may not have done for them, but it happens spontaneously. And then we start using that information when we work with other people. So the when it comes to installations, your life experience matters. And that's why in the earlier days, when there were community gatherings and where there were folk lore and things that were happening, it was always people who were above a certain age, because back then, your experience was directly proportional to how old you were. Today, your experience is proportional to what you have done in the life that you have lived. One of the advantages that Harney and I have is that we have worked with like over 10,000 people. One-on-one, we have seen with our eyes what installations do to a person a year from now. So we know, don't do this installation, don't do that installation, based on actual data, because one of the reasons we give unlimited revisits to people who come for up is because I want to see them after 3 months, I want to see them after 6 months, I want to see them after 1 year. I want to know what other installations can I do for them and what has been the impact of those installations. So if you're serious about doing installations, if you're serious about learning installations, create a context where you can learn about the effect of installations on people you are impacting over a long period of time. And the sad part about today's psychology, the sad part about today's therapist, the sad part about today's coaching is that the follow-through isn't there. You know, there's a research article by, I think, McKenzie that said that 85% of the coaches don't get their clients coming back the second time. And even if there is a second coaching process, it's limited. It's 3 months, it's 6 months, maximum 1 year. How does a coach learn? They don't know what's happened to their client 5 years from then. You know, you got to maintain that data. You got to understand, if you're serious about becoming a great coach, if you're serious about, you know, learning installations, you have to create the reality where you understand the impact of your work with each individual. What did you do? Why did you do? How did it impact this person in 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, 2 year, 3 year? Then you're serious about your development on the wisdom, on the insight to do installations in the right way.
What is the simplest, not simpler than the simplest, what's the simplest way in which you can explain to people what is something that Antano and Harney do that people who may be more experienced than Antano and Harney from the perspective, from the sense of maybe number of lives touched? Because I mean, so today I read biographies of so many people. Like sometimes there are people saying 2 lakh people. I've worked with 2 lakh people. I've worked with 2 million people. I've worked with 2 billion people across the world. What is it that Antano and Harney do to people that is unprecedented, unparalleled, never done before?
I think Antano and Harney, I think Harney and I possibly have the largest number of clients who we have followed through for 3 years or more. You know, there are people who have worked with 2 million people, 20,000 people. Question is not how many people you've worked with. Question is how many people did you work one-on-one and follow through their life journey for 2-3 years and understand the different aspects of their evolution. And in that sense, I think at this moment we have one of the largest libraries in the world of people one-on-one, their personal limitations, their unique situation, their unique installations, and what has been their journey. We have tracked that one-on-one for over 2 and even 3, and so some people for 5 years. That personal responsibility And at that scale, because I've seen people do 20,000 people, come, let me help you, go bye-bye. And I've seen people, let me hold your hand, I will take you through. But they would have worked with like 100 people in their career. I haven't seen people who have worked in thousands and yet one-on-one and over a period of time. And as much as there's a demand on us to do that, I feel like it is important for us to create the technology we are creating. One of the reasons we do one-on-one work, even though group work is more possible, more profitable, the reason we do one-on-one work is because it allows us to develop excellence installation technology. That there is going to come a point in time where we can code the consequences. We can make it simpler for people to understand and help another individual on developing capabilities that will change that person's trajectory.
I want to do a rapid fire round.
Okay.
Need like a quick one-liner on the kind of work that you've done with. So let's start with geniuses or super achievers, national achievers, people who have already done it and proven to the world. What can Antano and ONLY do?
I think one of the things that happens to geniuses is after they've achieved a particular point in life, they're very lonely. They don't find people of their caliber to connect with. And there's a saying that says, it's very lonely at the top. Because if you only have a life purpose, and if you've achieved it already, what do you do with the rest of your life? I think life is interesting when from one legacy, you hop onto the next legacy, and the next legacy. Because when you're on a journey of legacy, you have company. You know, there are people who team up with you to help you arrive there. And I think the most depressing feeling in the world is loneliness. And you see so many geniuses kill themselves of loneliness. You know, there are so many geniuses who have committed suicide over history because of the way they feel. So I think what we can definitely help geniuses is overcome that.
Coaches, consultants, trainers, what do I normally do for them?
Coaches, consultants, and trainers are running a race. They're always on their toes. I haven't met a single coach or a consultant or a trainer who is economically satisfied and not on their toes unless they are another league altogether. So I think that there's 1% of the coaches and traders who get all the business. And then there's like the 99% who are struggling over a very tiny market. So I think you could do whatever you do, but you gotta be the best at it. And what Harini and I do is help coaches, trainers, consultants become the best at what they do. And also teach them about change work and how to change and transform a person from within. So that the work they do sustains. See, because at the end of the day, how good you are and how much business you get is directly proportional to the results you create. So you help them create more results, they get more clients and they grow faster. That's how we get people get to the top.
Established professionals, chartered accountants, lawyers.
Chartered accountants and lawyers come to us for two things. One, they want a competitive edge over their colleagues. They want to understand the way language plays. They want to understand body language. But more importantly, they come because during their career, there's a significant period of their life they've compromised. With their children, with their family, some of them have the guilt, some of them want to make up for it, but they don't know what to do right now. They want to reset the pattern that they have created over the past few years. They have the intention, they even could make the time, but they don't know how to get things right. So, I mean, they're not in a dysfunctional family, they're in a happy family, but they know that it can be a lot better. And when they come to us, that's what they come for. So when people who are 25 years and younger come to us, it has most times resulted in accelerated promotions. We have our own team member. You know, he got 2 promotions in his company, and he got a promotion that is only given after 2.5 years of experience, but he got it within 3 months after up and within the first year of his work over there. And at the same time, he was also so efficient that he was able to do part-time work. So, you know, he was teaching German in one academy, also helping us with our work. And at the end of like 4 months after up, he had like additional 5 lakhs in his bank account. Now, for a 23-year-old, that's a lot of money. So when people come at the age of 24, 25, and they're already in a job, see, because when you're at that position, it's very easy to grow. Because generally, people at that age find it difficult to take ownership. And even if they want to take ownership, they're easily hurt, they're easily insulted. They're not able to create value for the organization they work for. But when people at 24, 25 come to us and we make them emotionally resilient, we help them take charge. We make sure that they're able to put their point across. They're able to learn, which is something that 24, 25 years lack a lot. They go into an office and they see that everything that the company is doing is wrong. They just know that the processes have to be different. They don't realize that things are there in that particular way for a purpose. So people of that age come, they start learning, they start appreciating what's there, and then they start fixing the gaps. And when they drive so much value, they get promotions. They get like 2-3 promotions really, really fast. And I really think that, you know, if somebody is joining a career, to them to reach a director level should not necessarily take 10-20 years. It happens because you create value. So for people at 25, I think by 30, they should be looking at being at a senior position, like a director level. They shouldn't be waiting till they're 45 or 50 to get there. And that's what we do for people at 25. We really help them get to the top faster. Most CXOs who have come to us have lived a good life. They're satisfied, but they want to do something purposeful and meaningful. They now want to contribute differently. Most of them end up becoming business owners. They start doing something. So people who are like CXOs, they have the money, they have the savings. Quitting their job is not going to financially impact them. But they want to do something meaningful, but they don't know how to do it, because it's one thing to be a CXO, it's another thing to have done business on your own. And the gap between being a CXO and a business owner is huge.
Why are people like Shiv Ratha so here?
Some people come just because they're fascinated. They are seeing something that hasn't happened anywhere. They have seen people through their lifetime struggle through small difficulties, struggle to overcome challenges. They've seen people's nature being fixed. And suddenly they've come to this place and they've seen people transform, and they're just fascinated. They're curious. They want to know what is going on. I mean, who wouldn't be fascinated? When people ask me, how did you stumble on installations? I'm like, who wouldn't be fascinated? If you see someone change in minutes, that you've known others been stuck for decades, and if you see a technology that gets people to consistently make that happen, wouldn't you be fascinated? I think when people are, you know, at a junior level, they are struggling for their own personal, you know, breakthroughs and things. But when people have got things sorted, they've have a happy life, they've accelerated success, their relationships are fine, I think they have the mind space to be curious. And people like Shiv and Sunir come because they're absolutely curious. They're like, what is this thing? How is it possible? And they're not coming with how is it possible in a skepticism. They're seeing it happen and they're coming with how is it possible from that space of curiosity. I'm not surprised, because that's who they are. That's made them so successful already. And I think successful people are always curious. They are curious to know how. And so the difference between a skeptic and a person who is curiously learning is that a skeptic is coming from a space that is not really connected to their life. See, a skeptic is looking at things in abstraction, right? They're looking at things as, would that work? But a curious person is always connected. It's either about their life or someone they care about. They have someone in their mind. They have seen someone go through that pain. There's that curiosity of, can that person be helped? And so they want it to work. And now they're coming and they're seeing it working. They're like, okay, how does this work?
What is the future of all of this?
I see the future of this being installations becomes a way of life. Just like there was once upon a time, nothing was IT enabled, and now everything is IT enabled. I mean, you can't run a business without being IT enabled. From accounting to your communication, everything is enabled with technology. In the same way, I think industries are going to become installation enabled. I think medicine is going to have a big, I hope medicine has a big change in the future, where preventive health takes precedence over fixing problems. And preventive health is the ability to notice something could go wrong in someone's health and fix it before it ever happens. And that requires lifestyle changes. That requires patterns changing. That requires habits changing. That requires installations, in my opinion. You need to change a person at the core if you have to give them new habits. And thereby, medicine can completely take a new preventive stance. I see hiring happening based on installations. I see education where people are making choices of what they want to learn, not based on what they can't learn, but what drives them, and seeing the combinations that will make it work for them. Today's education system is purely based on, I'm good at this, I'm not good at that. It's not based on, this is what I want to do in life, and let me get good at it. Because people can't get good at what they're not good at. And I think installations is a game changer there. People can get good at what they're not good at. I mean, we're all born with the same neurology. We may have experiential differences from experiences, but we can be good at whatever we want to be good at. So the choices have to be based on what you want to do, how you want to contribute, why you want to contribute, and not what you're good at this point in time or not. I mean, there are so many things that you can think of that you weren't good at one point in time that you're excellent at right now. There are so many things I can think of that I'm really good at doing, but at one point in time, I wasn't good at that. So I think the education system should not be based on what you're good at and what you're not good at. It should be based on what you want to do, why you want to do what you want to do. And I think installations becomes an enabler for that. So all of this is leading to a future where installations becomes a norm. It's like how you have IT enabled, you have installations enabled educational systems, installations enabled hospitals, installations enabled corporate bodies, and so on.
Why should people like Jeff Bezos or Elon Musk or Larry Page or Bill Gates pay attention to installation technology?
I'm pretty sure people at the top, specifically Silicon Valley owners, you know, billionaires, are exposed to the challenge of how difficult it is for someone to overcome their personal limitations. The higher you go in the ladder, the more you face the reality that the nature of people are difficult to change. This is like electricity. It's a fundamental change. You are learning, the excellence installation is a technology to change the nature of a person who wants to change the nature but is not able to change for years together. So I think anybody at the top who has recognized the difficulty in transformation, who realizes the temporary nature of coaching and training that is done in, you know, short durations, who recognizes the limitations in therapy, I think people at that nature and who have the ability to take a new technology to billions of people would definitely be fascinated about excellence installation technology, because you're literally doing something that the world has thought of as impossible until now. Where, I mean, you know, when you're a kid, you think anybody can change, just willpower, blah, blah, blah. But as you grow up and start facing the reality, when you see someone you love who can't stop drinking, the person the next day crying in tears and then can't stop drinking the next day. When you see someone you love being caught by anger, when you see someone you care about unable to overcome their stammering because of their anxieties, and you know that there's nothing out there that's helping them out, and then when you realize there's a technology that can help people change.
What's the business behind all this? What are even the possibilities and the business you know, one of the things that I've always heard you say is the technology is different from the business of the technology. Passion is different from the business of passion. What is the business behind it?
You know, when electricity was discovered, the business was electrical lights. So GE invested millions of dollars digging up the roads, laying the cables for electricity lines so that houses can have light bulbs instead of candle flames that were running on oil. And from there on, electricity took on a new shape. People started inventing machines. They started inventing washing machines and so on. And today, electricity is everywhere. There are hundreds and thousands of companies that are doing electrical products, but GE is still the dominator in the industry. GE still owns most of the market share for electrical appliances. And I think what we are building is a foundation for excellence installation technology. We teach it to people. I'm hoping that millions of people will join the ride, just like the IT revolution, to make business out of the installation technology. But what I want is a solid foundation, a solid network, based on top of which new applications can be built. And I want to be in all the sectors that can be installations enabled.